हेलो, हेलो स्टूडेंट्स, हेलो, कैन यू हियर माय वॉइस? हर्षिता, ओके सर, कैन यू स्टार्ट द क्लास? ओके फाइन. सो नाउ आई होप यू आर गेटिंग अ क्लियर साउंड, क्लियर वॉइस. होप देयर इज नो बैकग्राउंड साउंड. ओके, सो टुडे वी विल बी स्टार्टिंग सो टुडे वी विल बी स्टार्टिंग चैप्टर नंबर 7th. टुडे वी विल बी स्टार्टिंग योर नोट नंबर, स्टडी नोट नंबर 7. यस यस वरुण एंड हर्षिता. वरुण, आई जस्ट वॉन्ट टू क्लियर वन थिंग. लाइक इन लास्ट क्लास, अ डाउट यू गाइज हैव इन द लास्ट क्लास अबाउट दैट 30 डेज ऑफ रजिस्ट्रेशन पीरियड. आई जस्ट नीड टू क्लैरिफाई दैट. एक्चुअली वॉट यू वर सेइंग इज, वंस द person who is doing business deals into inward and outward supply, once they become eligible to get registered under GST, that means they crosses the threshold limit defined under GST act, then within 30 days they become due, they are liable to get themselves registered. There you are correct that 30 days time is there for those people to get themselves registered when they become liable or due to get registered under GST. What I was saying is 7 period times is, once a person applies for registration at the GST portal, then the process for registration defined as under the law gets completed within 7 days. Like maximum, if you have gone through the registration process under GST, maximum the GST department takes 7 days time to complete the registration. They take the certain explanations, queries if required. They just get take the information from the applicant, and once upon clarification, there are set deadlines that within these days they have to see, check, reply back, and ask the queries to the applicant. Then applicant is required to respond, and accordingly within 7 days the registration get complete. So that was the thing. You got it, Harshita? Varun? Okay. Okay, thank you for confirming. So now today we will just go through the note number 7. Note number 7 deals with the various accounts and records that are required to be maintained under GST. In the note number 6, we have studied about few of the documents, that is the tax invoice, debit note and credit note, and why those documents are important. In this note, we will study other documents apart from tax invoice and debit note and credit note. Along with that, we will just study what is the provisions related to the compulsory audit. That means the audit under GST is mandatory, but again there is a threshold limit. We will study in detail. Then the period for retention of accounts. That means whatever records you are maintaining, those records are required to be retained by the business houses for a certain specified period as defined under the law. Okay, so to start with, we will start with the accounts and records. Now, why there is a need of recording the transactions or to maintain the books of accounts? This is a basic principle we have He must have studied on since 11. We are studying that. Yes, we need to maintain the books of account. We need to record every transaction. There is a process of bookkeeping. Why we record? You know, the purpose is that you get the information, because no one can remember the transaction that you incurred one day back, 2 days back, or a week back, or a month back, or a year back. So it is always better to record all the transactions, and those recorded transactions are of immense help to the external users as well as to the management to take further decisions related to your business. Now, again, GST also, the GST department, why they made it mandatory to maintain the books and accounts? Because the GST department, they relied upon the documentary checks. They said, because every time when any statutory law comes, then the government has also made a procedure for audits, for checking those documents. So instead they said, ki we come physical and do the check physically and to have a physical control over the premises, they said ki we will verify the documents. So they developed a system and they made it obligatory or mandatory for the all the business houses, whosoever gets registered under the GST, to maintain certain records, to maintain books of accounts, so that the when the entries, transactions are entered into, what all tax has been paid or ITC has been availed by the registered dealers, that can be verified from the books of accounts. And moreover, that the government, the GST department has made, the GST council has made assessee to do the self-assessment of its books. They said, as you all know, that even in case of income tax or in case of individual tax, one is allowed to do self-assessment, that yes, my income was this much, and based on the law defined by the government, as per the applicable laws, this is the tax derived, and hence that has been deposited to the government. So similarly, in GST, the government has made all the assessees self liable to deposit the tax, and government checks, conducts the audit through verifying the documents. That is why it is an obligation on all the registered dealers to maintain the books of account. And the government has said, since now it is the period of globalization, all the people are maintaining books of accounts on any of the software. You must have heard about tally software, busy software, or ERP softwares, and SAP you must have heard about. So it depends upon all the volume of the transactions. So accordingly, every software is there to bear the load of the transactions. When you are having few transactions, you go for a smaller software. When you are having huge bulk of transactions, then you go for a larger ERP. Or when you are dealing multinational, you go for SAPs or like that. So in GST also, all the books of accounts maintained electronically are eligible, counted as that yes, the books of accounts are maintained by the registered dealer. Yes, Varun, there is no screen. You want what screen? You want me to share the screen? Let me just try. You want me to? I can just share the study note as of now. Will that be okay? Okay. Thank you. Hello students, are you there? I am unable to see the chat box and I am unable to see the screen. Yes, audible. Okay. Actually, when I display this PDF file, all the entire system get crash. So I am not able to share this note. But yes, we can just continue the chapter. And if you can just give me 5 minutes, some pop-up is again and again coming up. So I just need to close this and we'll rejoin this meeting. Please be there and sorry for the interruption. System is giving some problem. Some again and again, some message is popping up. ओके फाइन राजेश, जस्ट गिव मी अ मिनट, आई एम जस्ट रीलॉगिंग द मीटिंग. यस वी विल. थैंक्स अ लॉट अनिका, थैंक्स अ लॉट, थैंक्स अ लॉट. हेलो स्टूडेंट्स, हेलो, यस ऑडिबल, ओके. सो शैल वी स्टार्ट? ओके, सो एज वी वर डिस्कसिंग दैट वी नीड टू मेंटेन द रिकॉर्ड्स, books of accounts and records. So as per section, the section 35, are you carrying your notebooks? So page number 381, it is there. If you want to, you can open along with that. We are going through. Okay, so please go to 381 of the new revised version. Okay, so we see that what all books of accounts and records that are required to be maintained are governed under subsection 1 of section 35 of the CGST Act 2017. Correct? So every registered person is required to maintain a true and correct account of the following. Yes, always log This is the ask of the law that one has to maintain a true and fair and correct books of accounts. And apart from the tax invoice and other documents, the details related to the production. If you are into a manufacturing business, then all the details related to your manufacturing, like what is the quantity received by you, what is the quantity issued, what is the balance left over. So along with section 35, rule number 56 of the CGST rules 2017 governs what all records required to be maintained. So as it has been given under subsection 1 of section 35, the records are production or manufacture of goods. What all goods you are dealing into, what is the quantity output that is need to be maintained, what is the invert. Invert supply means what raw material has been received. If there are, say, the various particles are required, say in a garment company, if I take an example, it is not only the fabric you are getting as a raw material, it is the thread to stitch that garment, it is the labels. If you see on your tops on your garments, there are buttons, there are hooks, there are laces, there are embroidery work, that all are consumables that is required to bring in. So that is all your inward supply of goods that is required to be maintained. And is the outward supply. Once the garment is manufactured, then you are making an outward supply, that is selling that garment. So all the records of what raw material has been received and what is the final product that has been sent for sale is required to be maintained. Stock of the goods. What is the various type of stocks that is required to be maintained? It is the stock of raw material, the stock of work in progress, WIP, and the stock of finished goods. So the stock at various levels should be maintained by any registered dealer. Input tax credit received. In what is the input tax credit? Like your account should be maintained, which reflects when you are making the hook in your accounts, you have studied the accounting entry. So when you are recording the purchase, you record the entry of tax as well. Suppose you have purchased a material of 100 rupees and paid a tax of 5 rupees on that. The invoice amount was 100 rupees and 5 rupees is the tax, 95 rupees is the material cost. So what the entry you pass is, you pass purchases account debit, input tax credit rupees 5 to supplier account. This is the entry. So by that, as soon as we debit the input receivable account, that means we have recorded what is the ITC eligible to be availed. And once it is availed, accordingly we pass the opposite entry once we are availing. So automatically when we are passing the entries into the books of account, these records are maintained. Any other particular deemed necessary is required to be maintained. So any other particulars that are deemed to be necessary are further elaborated in rule number 56. So as we go down, you see there are around 18 sub rules of rule 56, which are defining what all various records are required to be maintained. So rule number sub-rule 1 of rule 56 states that what you are procuring domestically, apart from that, if there is any import of raw material, that is again to be maintained separately. And if a registered dealer is into export of their product, that record is also required to be maintained. And apart from that, there is, as we have discussed in last class also, that tax is liable to be paid under reverse charge mechanism. So whenever the tax is paid under reverse charge mechanism, all the relevant documents related to reverse charge mechanism, that is invoices, because a registered dealer is dealing with the unregistered one, and because he is dealing with the unregistered dealer, they have to pay the tax under reverse charge mechanism. They are going to raise the tax invoice, and hence what they are required to maintain, it is the invoices or the bill of supply, like in case of composition scheme or the exempted scheme, the bill of supply is being raised. Delivery challans, when we are dealing into multiple shipments, multiple lots, then delivery challans are required. Credit notes, debit notes, receipt voucher, payment voucher, refund voucher, and e-way bills. These all documents we studied in our previous class. So if there is any doubt in any of this document, you can raise your question in the chat box. So Sabrul, is it clear now, till now? Okay, so sub-rule 2 of rule 56 of the CGST Act defines like that all the registered person other than the person paying tax under section 10. Now, who is the person who gets registered under section 10? Any idea? Who is the person? What kind of person gets registered? What is this kind of registration done under section 10? Section 10 governs with the composite scheme. That means person who has registered under the composite scheme. Other than that, all other registered dealers are required to maintain the following books of accounts. What are these? That their account should contain the following particulars, to be specific. That is the opening balance, the receipt of the material, the supply of the material, goods lost, stolen, destroyed, written off, disposed of by way of gift, free samples, the balance of stock including raw material, finished goods, scrap, wastage thereof. Means every, once you have ordered your material, the material is in transit. In transit, that material can be stolen. Once it is received, you are going to store that material, getting it processed, converting into finished product and supplying that. So once it is in the finished form, you might be distributing as a free sample also. Within factory also, there can be full fridge. During production, there can be wastages. And once it is produced, like you are making a garment, so many, once you have cut the like the size of the garment, the leftover piece is termed as scrap. So record is required to be maintained for all these areas. So now can you just tell me, can we avail the ITC for the goods that have been lost? Can we claim the ITC for the goods lost? Yes, because to claim the ITC, the goods we are procuring should be used in the course of furtherance of business. Yes, Siddhan. Yes, Siddharth. Yes, Harshita, it is correct. Because we are only eligible to take ITC when we are, whatever we are supplying is going to be used in the course of furtherance of business. So that is why, since goods lost will not be used in the course of furtherance of business, and hence on the goods lost, no ITC can be claimed by registered dealer. So moving ahead. Sub-rule 3, here it is written, it means the above records are not required to be maintained by a supplier opting for composition levy. Fine. Now moving to sub-rule 3 of rule 56 of the CGST Act 2017, which states that every registered person shall keep and maintain a separate account of advances received, advances paid and adjustment made. So, means apart from the invoices, you have to maintain the record of all the adjustments, the advances that has been received on account of material. Right? Now moving ahead, means it is a very simple and very short chapter. It is of 4 pages around. So quickly we will just cover this thing. So the next rule states about rule number 4, sub rule 4 of section 50, rule number 56. Which states about that all the person have to maintain the records which are covering the details of the tax payable, like what all records they are, including tax payable in accordance with the provisions of subsection 3 of section 4, like subsection 3 and subsection 4 of section 9 of the CGST Act deals with the tax amount payable. So you have to maintain the record of what is the tax collected, and you are registered dealer is liable to pay the input tax credit claimed, along with the register of tax invoices, credit note, debit note, delivery challan received during any of the tax period. Tax period means or return period for which you have to file the return. Like in GST, you have to monthly file the return, and then later on for the year you have to file the annual return, which we are going to discuss in this chapter later. So sub rule 5 of rule 56 states that every registered person shall keep the particulars related to the suppliers. Like if you are procuring the material, the detail of all the suppliers. If you are selling the material, then the name of all the suppliers is required to be maintained by the person, along with the complete addresses and premises where in transit the stock has been stored. Like at times transporters are taking stock in bulk, they for some time the stock, the goods are being stored in their warehouses, so the record should be maintained for those places also. Now sub-rule 6 of rule 56 deals with that. It is again talking about the place of storage. Place of storage. So if any taxable person, if any taxable goods are found to be stored at any place other than those declared under sub-rule 5 without the cover of any valid document, the proper officer shall determine the amount of tax payable on such goods as if such goods have been supplied by the registered person. Which means, which states that if, see, when you are doing the registration, you define a places of registration, places of additional, place of additional businesses is given into the while doing registration under GST. If the goods are stored at any other place for which registration has not been taken, then it is presumed that those goods have been supplied and the registered person is liable to pay tax and the appropriate officer can claim tax on those goods. Now, sub-rule 7 of rule 56 states that every person shall keep books of accounts. Now, where the books of accounts are required to be maintained? At the principal place and every additional place of business which has been defined during the registration. It should be maintained, and in this rule only they have very well covered that any books of accounts maintained in electronic form is equally eligible to suffice the requirement under the law that yes, books of accounts have been maintained. Now, sub-rule 8 of 56 states that an entry in register accounts and documents shall not be erased. That means once the entry has been made, it should not be erased. It should not be, there should not be overwriting, okay, except if there is any clerical error, that is fine. But if there is no, there should not be overwriting. If there is mandatory to be done, it should be properly attested by the appropriate officer. So hence, no editing is required, no editing is allowed under the Act. And even there are vouchers are deleted, a log of deleted vouchers is required to be maintained by the registered dealer. Clear? Now going to further moving to sub-rule 9 of rule 56 of the CGST Act. Now each volume of books of accounts maintained manually by the registered person shall be serially numbered. Like we have studied, everything should be serially numbered. We have studied about tax invoices, we have studied about the debit notes, credit notes. Similarly, if your books of records are maintained manually, because register is limited, so you are going to use number of registers during the year, they should be chronologically ordered or they should be given a serial number. Now, just moving to rule number, sub-rule number 10 of rule number 56, which states that unless proved otherwise, if any document registered or any books of accounts belonging to a registered person are found at any premises other than mentioned in the certificate of registration. That means if a registered person, they have given certain places of registration during their registration, but apart of from those places, if any registered person has maintained the account some other place also, unless and until that registered person provides that no, these are not books of accounts, the GST department will consider those books of accounts also that they, as if it has been maintained by that registered person only related to that business. So that means assessee has to clearly state that yes, these are the books that are related to his or her business. Now, moving to rule number, sub-rule number 11. Sub-rule 11 of rule 56 talks about what all documents are required to be maintained by an agent. Now, if suppose you are the principal, you cannot have your presence at the very beginning of your business in all the states or globally in many countries. So what you do, to expand, you hire an agent. Okay, now agent is going to do the business on your behalf. You will be the principal. So now what all records that are required to be maintained by an agent, that is, that those provisions are covered under sub rule 11 of rule 56, which states that whatever accounts, books of accounts they are maintaining, they should depict following clauses. There are 5 clauses. One is, first is particulars of authorization received by him from each principal. Now an agent is not limited to work to a single principal. Yes, agent maintain records. Yes, Harshita, agent has to maintain. Principal also has to maintain the records, and the agent has also maintained the records, required to maintain. That means what sort of agent has to maintain the records? It is that he has received authorization from the principal. If he is dealing from one to more than two principals, he should receive authorization from all the principals to sell the goods, to deal into the goods on their behalf and to the location as discussed in conformity with the principal. So they have to maintain this record. What is the type of record? The authorization received from all the principals. Thank you, Harshita, for confirming. Now point B is particulars including description, value, quantity. As we have studied, tax invoice also covers all these things, the description, the value and quantity. So similarly, agent, whatever he is dealing into, selling on behalf of the principal, he should maintain a record. Like what he is procuring, it should be maintained, giving the particulars, quantity, rate, what he has supplied or sold off on behalf of principal, what is the stock remaining. So he has to maintain all that. These are the like points B, C are covering those only. What he has received, what he has supplied, he has to maintain a record. Then detail of account furnished to every principal. Somewhere in 11th or 12th, you must have studied the consignment account. So if you remember, the agent has to report what all, give an account that yes, this is the quantity and this is the amount cash they have received, and this is the cash the agent has earned by supplying the material on behalf of principal, and this is the balance cash after meeting the expenses which he has to reimburse to the principal. So that is the detail of account. So what any detail of account that is furnished by the agent to the principal should be maintained in writing from the GST perspective. Account sales, Varun, can you please elaborate what is account sales? What you mean to say, what you are referring to account sales? Can you please elaborate that? You can speak also. I was referring to consignment as you say. Yes, because agent and principal concept only comes when we are dealing on consignment, and consignment accounts are maintained. That is going to meet the purpose of this GST also. Yes, correct. So now moving further, in E point, tax paid on receipt or on supply of goods or services affected on behalf of every principal. Definitely when you are buying or you are selling the goods, that means if there is any inward supply or there is an outward supply, agent is passing an accounting entries related to tax also, and by passing those entries they are maintaining the record of the relevant tax they are collecting and claiming for input tax credit. An agent can also claim the input tax credit, right? So moving further, rule 12 of sub rule 12 of rule 56 states that, now they are talking about the monthly production records. This sub rule 12 of rule 56 talks about the raw material related records that needs to be maintained on monthly basis. So what they are stating, that any dealer who is into manufacturing, they should maintain on monthly basis the quantitative records of raw material or services used in the manufacture, and quantitative details of the goods so manufactured, including the waste and byproducts thereof. Means if we can cover this chapter or the first two pages, it is a very simple that yes, every registered dealer has to maintain what they are procuring, what they are manufacturing, what is the wastage, what is the scrap, and what they are supplying in quantitative terms, in their value terms, and what the tax they have paid or collected. This is all about the records they have to maintain, and these to be maintained on daily basis. Like entry should be passed on daily basis. So moving further is like sub rule 13 of rule 56, which states that every registered person supplying services shall maintain the account showing quantitative details of goods used in the provision of services, detail of input services utilized, and the services supplied. Like even in case of services, they should maintain the inward and outward supply. At times, like in work contract, at times the service provider is also supplying the material. Like if in your home, you must have seen a very small example, if there is any repair related to your washing machines or to your burners or to your filter, they are coming and changing the part also which is damaged, along with they are taking the service charges. So they are supplying the material also, and they are providing the services also. So in that case, means a registered person who is dealing into supplying of services, they also have to maintain the record that yes, this is the material supply, and through this person they have supplied the services of installation of machine or replacement of this part. Like that, they have to give the description of the services so provided. Hope it is clear till now. Okay, thanks Varun for confirming. So now sub-rule 14 of rule 56, which talking about the work contract only, like just now I've explained. So these are the documents they have to maintain, like the name and address of the person on whose behalf the work contract is executing. That means a person is executing and there is some company behind that, so they should keep in record that for Samsung or for Hitachi, for any brand, they are providing these services. They are the registered dealers and they are providing services for so and so person or company. Then the description, value, quantity, what, wherever applicable, of goods and services rendered for execution of work contract. Then it is description, value, quantity of goods or services utilized in execution. Means what kind of services you are going to do and what has been actually utilized, that you have to maintain a record of that. Then the detail of the payment received in respect to the work contract. Whosoever is coming to your house for repair work or any installation purpose, they take their charges, visit charges, like that. So any agent who is providing a work under work contract, that needs to be maintained. The name and address of supplier from whom he received goods and services. Like if you are simply an intermediary, like you are just connecting two people, one is the service provider and one is the user, you are sitting in between. So you have to maintain the record of from whom you are taking the services or buying the goods and supplying it to that. So you have to maintain all these records in reference to the work contract. So a very small question can come in exams, like what sort of accounts are required to be maintained for a specific person. So now sub-rule 15 or 56 states that record under the provision of this chapter may be maintained in electronic form, which they are repeating, but specifically in sub-rule 15 it has covered, yes, that electronically maintained records are authenticated and they are well accepted by the GST department or under the GST Act. And they should be digitally signed. They should be authenticated, means they should be approved. Electronically maintained record should be authenticated by a digital signature. Now, sub-rule 16 of rule 56 states that, again, they are saying about that, that any registered person together, means they are talking about even if their goods are procured at any warehouse or any other place, they should maintain the records of that other place also. I just give a reading of this sub-rule. Account maintained by the registered person together with all the invoices, bill of supply, credit debit note, delivery challenge related to stock, deliveries, inward supply, outward supply, shall be preserved for a period as provided in Section 36. Yes, Section 36 deals with the period for which till when a registered person is required to maintain the records. And this provision is just covering that pay for that period the books of account should be kept maintained by the registered tenure. It can be digitally or it can be manually. So sub rule 17 of rule 56 states, like if any person having custody over the goods in the capacity of a courier or a clearing and forwarding agent, when you are dealing into import of service goods or export of goods, that means you must have studied about the clearing and forwarding agents. They are the intermediary. They take the goods from us, get it cleared for us from the customs, and they hand over the goods or the shipment to the authorized people of the buyer. So for this entire process to get complete for a few hours or a day or two, they have to keep the goods with them. Okay. So they are authorized to maintain the goods over there. So if they are authorized, that means the registered dealer who is supplying the material should maintain on behalf of these that his goods are maintained over there. What is the quantity of the goods, value of the goods should be maintained by the registered person, and they clearing and forwarding agent and the carrier are also required on behalf of the registered person to maintain the records, what all quantity they are having. And it is further stated, on behalf of such registered person shall produce the details thereof as and when required by the proper officer. Means if you are clearing and forwarding and carrier is maintaining, if a proper officer wants, they have to produce those things to them. Now there is one provision in this notification that it has been clarified that if the recipient, if the recipient, at times what has happened in case of Amazon or something, there are Amazon mein toh it's fine, not on behalf of the recipient, but yes, on behalf of the Amazon, the goods are stored into the warehouses on behalf of the recipient of those goods. But in case of the registered dealer, let us not take this retail example. We'll take an example of a manufacturer. Suppose you are supplying a goods from, say, Haryana to Maharashtra, and once the goods are entered into Maharashtra, the recipient has added the place of the transporter as an additional place of business, then that recipient can ask the transporter to retain those goods for a certain period of time. Then that transporter's place will be treated as an additional place of the business, and the recipient and the transporter are required to maintain those records of those goods. Clear? Is it clear? Okay, Saili. Okay, Varun. Okay, Harshita. Thank you. So now, there is one in case of transporters also, because a notification has came in June 2018, transporters are also having their offices at multiple locations. Okay, so to give them a comfort, they are also supposed to take a separate registration. Okay, so they are also having a separate presence in all the locations. So what the department has allowed by giving this by amendment the GST, and under this notification they allowed that they can enroll themselves under a unique common enrollment number under form GST ENR 02, and then once they are get enrolled, they are not required to file a separate GSTR return. They can just operate across India using that one unique common enrollment number. This is the comfort that has been given to the transporters. Now e-way bill. E-way bill is like clarification on e-way bill in case storing of goods in godowns of transporters. Like as we have discussed in the last class also, e-way bill, based on the distance, the validity of the e-way bill gets increased. So if the recipient of the goods has added the transporter's place as an additional place of business, then the e-way bill gets closed once the goods are received at the transporters. Now, if from the transporter's place the goods are required to be shipped to the receiving place, a separate e-way bill is required to be raised. That means you cannot just extend the original e-way bill. Yes, seeing that the goods are lying at the transporter's place and has not been handed over to the recipient, that is not there. Once the recipient has added the transporter and address as his additional place of business, then the e-way bill, it is presumed once the goods are delivered to the transporter's place, the e-way bill is closed. Clear this point? Okay. Thank you. Double voice coming. Prem Pratap, is it my only or? Now is it better? Okay. Thank you, Varun. Okay, Prem Pratap. Okay, fine. So now there are certain, I'm just moving to synopsis, that the para explained that only. So synopsis, there are few points that is giving a further clarification to the understanding. The first point is about that the place of business now also includes a warehouse. That means earlier the place of business was only where some manufacturing activity or the through which the services are being supplied, but later on the warehouses, godowns are also included as the place of business, and a registration is required. Suppose in one state you are only having the warehouse and in the other state you are having your branch which is dealing into maybe production process or into supply of services. So the state having warehouse also requires registration under GST, and the state you are having the corporate office or the branch or the production unit also requires registration under GST. Yes, synopsis. Harshita, I am going through synopsis. Acha, you are having the old book, na? Varun, Harshita is having old book or you are having... Is synopsis is covered under old book? Yes. So Harshita, when you see the PDF, and all these PDFs are available on the institute website in the students e-service section. So you can download, and this is the revised version. You can take note of the page number. 384 is the page number. Okay, 304. So, Sayali, is the synopsis is covered in that old book, old version? So, Harshita, you can refer page number 304. Okay, great, Harshita. So, just go to page number 384 and you will see the synopsis. Okay, so hope you have opened this page number 84. So place of even the place of business includes the place of warehouse or godown or any other place where a taxable person stores in goods. What is the fundamental? Wherever the registered person stores its goods, that will be included into the place of business. Okay. That means, and second point is what I have just explained about the e-way bill. That e-way bill, if the transporter's godown is included into the place of business, additional place of business of the recipient, then the e-way bill gets deemed to be concluded. That means e-way bill gets closed once the goods are delivered at the transporter's godown. Okay, So third point is the recipient will be required to maintain books of accounts in relation to the goods stored at the goods of the transporter. Who is responsible? It is the recipient. But in earlier rules, we have also stated that transporter is also required to maintain, and if ever required by the appropriate officer, those documents should be produced. Hope it is clear till now. Okay, Harshita, you also? Okay, fine. So now we just move to, till now we have studied. So what all documents, books of accounts or records required to be maintained under GST? We have studied in chapter 6 in detail and till now in note number 7. Okay, no further notes are covering related to records to be maintained under GST. Now we will just move to compulsory audit. As the topic itself states that audit is mandatory under GST. Every person who gets registered has to go through this process, has to file the returns at the defined schedule, and has to get the books audited. Now, the audit provisions are covered under Section 35. Along with Rule 80 of the CGST Rules 2017. Now, what they said? They said that every registered person whose turnover, again, there is a threshold limit. What is the threshold limit? Threshold limit is of 2 crores. Any registered person who is having turnover in the previous year. Previous year means right now we are sitting in October 2020. That means we have to file the annual return under GST for the period of 19-20 by 31st December 2020. Mm-hmm. That is another thing that government are giving extensions seeing this pandemic situation, or there are at times the flood situation or the drought situation, other natural calamitic situations. There are extensions of the date. But if we don't consider the extension, what law has originally stated that yes, every registered person whose turnover in the year, say 1920, exceeds 2 crores, then they have to file the annual return by 31st December 2020. Hope it is clear. So, every registered person whose turnover during the financial year exceeds the prescribed limit. Prescribed limit is 2 crore. In the next para, they have given the this 2 crores shall get his accounts audited by the chartered accountant or post accountant. So you have, you are pursuing the course of CMA certified and management accountant. So later on you are eligible to find the annual audits of GST. Clear? If you are in practice, if you are not working with the company, if you are doing your own practice, you can sign the GST returns. And this has come under this, and there is one amendment which states this notification 49 of 2018 came in 13 September 2018, that there the central or state government or local authority books of accounts are liable to be audited by CAG. There is no further audit is required by a CA or CME. For all the government establishment or government offices, CAG will be doing the audit, and it is not the CA or CME. But for all the private sectors, it is the CMA or CA can do the audit. Okay. So this is all about the notification. We have gone through the threshold limit. So with this, we have just closed the compulsory audit. So to further elaborate this point, I can just tell you briefly about what all returns are there. Maybe later in any of your notes it will be covered that normally there are returns filed on monthly basis as GSTR1, which is of outward supplies, GSTR3B, where a registered person is liable to pay the taxes, and deadlines are defined, and one is the annual return. These are the returns that are, and There are various other, these are the three main documents, returns that are required to be filed by every registered person. But there are certain other form of returns that are eligible or to a specific sort of activity or to a dealer. That we are going to study in detail, all the forms of return. Right? So now period of retention of account. As we have studied in one of the clauses earlier, in one of the rules, that section, the time frame defined under section 36, the registered dealer is required to maintain the account for that period. So what is the time period, time frame? It is at least 72 months, that is 6 years from the due date of furnishing the annual return. Let us get a clarity here. What is the period for which the return is to be filed, by when it is to be filed, and from that period till when the records are required to be maintained. Just see example number one. For the year 2017-18, the due date of filing the annual return will be 31st December 2018. That means the due date, the last date of filing the annual return is 31st December of the following year. Say 17-18. Then return should be filed by December, 31st December 18. 18-19, return should be filed, annual return should be filed by 31st December 2019, and likewise. And see, accordingly, the books of records should be maintained for 6 years. That is, what is the date of filing the annual return? 31st December 2018. The record should be maintained till 31st December 2024. Is it clear? Now, there is another modification, like in case if there is any investigation. Suppose in the sixth year, some assessment has happened, some investigation has been done by the department. So, the registered person, the assessee, is required to maintain the books of record for one more year. For one more year. From the date when the such proceedings or appeal has been passed. Means once the proceedings has been cleared, order has been passed by the appellant authority, after passing that order till 1 year period, they have to maintain the record. Clear? Okay, thank you. Now, this is in relation to, this is the last leg of this chapter. We are about to complete this note. Achha. Harshita, you are talking about this example one, that if the taxpayer, I am just reading the language of the law written in the note and then we will further elaborate it. If the taxpayer is the part of any proceedings before any authority, that means some of the assessment is going on, investigations are being going on by the department related to the books of accounts of any registered processee. Okay, or is under investigation, then he must maintain the books for 1 year. After 1 year period starts when? After the order of such proceedings appeals has been passed. What? How I have just correlated or explained is, for 72 months or 6 years you have to maintain the records. Okay, Harshita. So say even if on during the sixth period you have filed the annual return on 31st December 2018 and you are supposed to maintain the records for 6 years, and on the 6th year department held some investigation, passed an order, then after passing the order for a pay from that date till one more year, yes, 6 plus 1 extra needed if there is any investigation happened on the 6th year. Investigation happened during the 6th year. Correct? So now there is last leg on this, in this study note 7th is, what all records that are required to be maintained by the principal and the auctioneer. This is in specific to the case of tea, coffee or rubber. Like tea plantation, coffee plantation, you must have seen in Himachal or southern states, lot of tea manufacturing, coffee, and some auction might be going out, although I'm not having that detailed experience internally related to tea industry or coffee industry. So if there is an auction going on in case of this tea, coffee or rubber, then what all records that are required to be maintained is given in this note. So there is one circular which has given further clarification to what all records that are required to be maintained by the principal and auctioneer. So the clarification to same is as normally what we have studied till now is the records that are required to be maintained by all, whether it is auctioneer or principal or agent or a normal registered dealer. Okay, so in this case, what are further clarification is given the related to the accounts that needs to be maintained by the auctioneer is given here. So the books of accounts will be maintained at the principal place of business and additional place of business as follows. Again, they are dealing with the same things, only we will just give a reading. The principal and the auctioneer may declare the warehouse where such goods are stored as their additional place of business. This is what we have studied. But when there is a case of tea, coffee, rubber, they are talking about. So words used will be principal and auctioneer. Again, they have to add the auctioneer's place as their additional place of business. If principal is storing at some other place or even auctioneer is storing at some other place, that other place should be added as the additional place of business in their registrations. Then they are supposed to maintain the records. The buyer is also required to disclose such warehouse as his additional place of business if he wants to store the goods purchased through auction in such warehouse. Now, say suppose auctioneer's warehouse is different and the buyer's warehouse is different and buyer's working place is different. So from the auctioneer warehouse, buyer can place the goods at his warehouse. So all the records are also required to be maintained, and that buyer should cover that warehouse where that buyer is storing the goods in case of this also as an additional case of business. Means those clauses are further applicable to the tea and coffee business in case of auction. So now, for the purpose of supply of tea through a private treaty, the principal and an auctioneer may also comply with the said provision. The principal and auctioneer are required to maintain the books of accounts relating to each and every place of business in that place. If means in that place, it well, whatever places they are maintaining, they have to just maintain the record. However, in case of any difficulty, okay, what the law is stating, if there is any difficulty for maintaining the books of accounts for any such additional place, okay, then the principal and auctioneer are required to intimate they're unable to maintain the books of accounts to the judicial officer in writing about the same. And the principal and auctioneer shall be eligible to avail input tax credit subject to fulfillment of other provisions of the CGST Act that with the rules made therein. That means because of any issue, and if they are able to convince the principal officer, still they are eligible to take the input tax credit. Because if you are not maintaining the tax invoice or anything else at that place, but you have maintained, say, at the warehouse you are not able to maintain, but at the main office you have maintained, then also you are eligible to take the input. The government will not say that you have not maintained the records in the warehouse, you cannot claim the ITC. You can claim that if it is justified to the principal officer. Yes, see, it is, they have just given tea, coffee or the estate. Probably they have raised this point in this industry. So we can further, or I'll just check this, that who all are involved. If there is any exhaustive list, I can share this list with you. Okay, so normally whenever there is a word called auctioneer and GST is there, GST, they are registered under GST, GST laws are applicable to them, then they have to maintain the record. So if there is any exhaustive list specific to this circular, I will share it with you definitely in the coming class. I'll just check out and will share it. Okay, Harshita. So with this, the note number 7 gets completed. Is there any doubt related to note number 7? Okay, anyone else? Okay. Varun, Harshita, and all others. Okay. See, the way I am explaining the things, is it okay, comfortable, understandable? Or you are looking for any improvements? Because all good. Okay, thanks a lot. Now, because there are very issue to understand. Very issue to understand means? Harshita, okay, easy. Okay, very easy to understand. Okay, thank you. Because in law, at times you have to go by the provisions given under the law. If we are not reading, at times there are certain words. This was a simple note. You can yourself also study it and could have got an understanding. But at times there are notes that having a typical words, then the explanation is required. So at times it is required. But so far the numerical problems are concerned or everything, then we can just discuss other examples also to have an understanding, good understanding about the subject, about the topic. Okay, so now the next note is about the payment of tax. Okay, so shall we start it with the next class about this, because many of the students, seeing it's a simpler topic, have logged off. There were about 17 students, but now 11 students are there. 13 students were there in between. So shall we start this payment of tax in the next class, or what, how you would like to continue? Because it will involve like how the computation should be made, how the ITC will be adjusted, availed, claimed, and there was some technical issue. We can start in next class. Yes. Okay, for the students you are telling. Okay, fine. Because it is something important topic, payment of tax. So if everyone will have a good understanding, you may get a numerical question in your exam from this, that how the liability is computed, accessible value, like that. Okay, fine. So hope all are aligned with Varun. So we will start this in the next class. I'll just check with the team that if I can, I don't know what is the technical gap, as and when I'll just try to share this PDF file during the meeting, everything system gets stuck. So I'll just check out with the institute if anything can be sorted out. We will sort out, and in the next class, hopefully we'll able to see what we are discussing in turn. Thanks a lot, Varun, for bearing up in this class. So shall we log off for today? Okay, Saili. Okay, Varun. Thanks a lot to all the participants for listening patiently. Thank you. Thank you, students. I'm logging off now.